set the scene a little bit. This is probably the last commemorative event for 1916 this year. We're not sure, there may be others somewhere else in the country, but we're claiming that it is actually the last. The significance for us is, for this time of year, is that this is a time of year when a lot of the people that were actually interned after 1916 were actually released just around Christmas. And for instance, we'll be talking about Peter McCarlin, and he was actually released on the 24th of December, just in time for Christmas, and be able to come back home, be with his sons and daughters, just down here in Dorset Street. So the walk we're doing, the route we're doing, I think I've explained it to most people, it's going as far as just past Binns Bridge, just at the edge of Dorset Street, then coming back into Iona for a little bit, working our way back down into Carlingford Roads, and then stopping here at Hollybank Road. And then we will be assembling in Kennedy's, there'll be sandwiches, there's an exhibition there, and we produced a pamphlet. There's a talk that we're actually giving is just the bullet points from that pamphlet. So if you want to read more about it, you can do so as well at the at Kennedy's afterwards. So we just proceed onwards. I think just all you have to do is follow the flags, okay? Normally you have these guys with umbrellas, but we have we're well organized, we have flags, okay? Okay. This is the home of Pierce Baisley, okay? So Pierce Baisley was one of the people involved in the years leading up to 1916. His main involvement was in the cultural revival that actually took place, and he even had a drama group, an Irish drama group called Mahastory. He was also on the steering committee that met in Wynn's Hotel, who actually found the Irish Volunteers in November 1913. So he's involved all the way up. He then became a vice commandant of the 1st Battalion, and he actually took part in 1916 as vice commandant of the 1st Battalion. And they actually assembled in and around the forecourts, all that area, Church Street, etc. like that. So the idea of the forecourts was to actually stop any of the troops coming in along from Euston Station, basically from the west. But the other idea of it was that they wanted to keep a corridor open along the Fisborough Road, up through Glasnevin, and then up through Finglas. So the idea was that if they did, you know, have to make a break for it, that they could actually make a break and actually fight a war, or a guerrilla war, outside Dublin, to be able to continue the struggle on in that way, okay? He, obviously when he surrendered, he ended up in Lewis prison, and then he was released then later that year as well, okay? So that was Pierce Baisley. And we will be talking about various battalions, and we will find that the 1st and 2nd battalions, most of the people that we'll be talking about are involved with the 1st and the 2nd Battalions, because they were on the north side of the city, whereas you had the 3rd and the 4th Battalions mainly centred around the south side of the city. So people from the south side of the city joined those battalions. The people from the north side mainly joined the 1st and the 2nd Battalions. So we move on next, we'll be down just there at Twins Pub, and we'll be talking about a few more people there as well, okay? Thank you. Three people here, Clonliffe Road, we're obviously not going to go down Clonliffe Road, but there's three people here that we've written about in the pamphlet, okay? And the first one is Harry Colley. Now he was very involved, but he didn't get involved till later on. He joined the Volunteers in 1914, just after they were founded. But he was heavily involved in 1916. But he was one of the Volunteers that assembled at Father Matthew Park. He was part of the 2nd Battalion, which was Thomas McDonough's battalion, who, as you probably know, were mainly in Jacob's factory. But some of them then, after the Count demanding order, were given orders to assemble a fighter merchant in Fairview, which is what he did. And they actually occupied the bridges at Ansley Bridge and at Ballybock Bridge, and then some of the houses around. So this is where they did a lot of the fighting. And they had scouts coming up here, even as far as from Drumcondra Road, watching for British troop movements. Now, they weren't really that successful in holding off the Brits, but they did have a good engagement with the Brits, which forced them back down and did delay them for a little while from getting into the city centre. He later went down to the GPO, where he was assigned to the Imperial Hotel, and that was bombarded. They had to make a run for it. They made a run for it down towards Gardner Street, down towards what was called then Gloucester Street, now Sean McDermott Street. And he ended up having to run at a barricade because there's nowhere else to go. And he was actually baited it, so he was severely wounded. And he was taken, I think, to Dublin Castle, the hospital, after he was arrested with the British. The other person that's we're talking about down here is Maurice Collins. And he was involved from 1908, he was involved with the IRB. And that's how he came to join the volunteers. He was instructed to actually go to the meeting which actually founded the volunteers in the Rotunda in November 1913. His main involvement was with the arrest and the detention of Bulmer Hobson. Bulmer Hobson had been an IRB member, he was on the Supreme Council, but he didn't favour the rising, and he got wind that the rising was being organised by Pearce, etc. So he was with McNeil and encouraged him to try and stop the rising. So the volunteers decided something needed to be done about him. So they arrested him and they brought him up to Cabot Park. And that was Maurice's Collins' first job as part of the Easter 1916 rising. Then eventually when they released Bulmer Hobson, they held him till about Wednesday. They thought that was enough time, you couldn't do any damage after that. Maurice Collins then was assigned to the area in Short Street because he was a member of the 1st Battalion, like I said, the same as Piers Baisley. The other person we talked about was a 13-year-old young lad, William Fox. He was just really an innocent bystander. He paid a visit down into town and he was shot outside the Pro Cathedral. The British were actually shooting people coming out of the Pro Cathedral. They maybe thought it was a building occupied by the insurgents, and he was shot down there. He was probably only there just out of curiosity. Okay, so we'll move on, and we'll the next stop is there. We're dealing with two people here that we have in the pamphlet. The first one is Pater Kearney. Everybody, or a lot of people, might know Pater Kearney for actually writing "Hour on the Field," a national anthem, originally known as the Soldier Song. But that was a song that was very nearly not written, okay? Because what Pater had done, he'd written the words, and he was getting a very close friend of his that lived close enough to hear to actually write the tune, but your man got stuck in the tune. So Pater paid a visit to him, and your man got so fed up he threw the manuscript on in the fire. But luckily enough, Pater managed to get it out quickly. He calmed them down and they wrote the tune. The Soldier Song, as it originally known, that was written in 1907. But it was used by the volunteers as a marching song, and it was used by the volunteers as well in 1916 when they were occupying the positions, and even when after surrender, when some of them marched out of the positions as well. Pater Kearney was involved in 1916, he was a member of the 2nd Battalion, so he was actually in Jacob's factory. He did mention in his testimony that in the preparations leading up to 1916, when they were drilling and marching, there used to be something like maybe 200 in his company. But when they actually assembled at Stephen's Green to march up to Jacob's factory, there was only two of them from his company. You know, so that was the effect of the countermanding order at the time. That was a story that could be repeated throughout the city and throughout the country as well, as everybody probably has heard before. They were in Jacob's factory, there wasn't quite a lot to do, but the one thing they did have, they had plenty of biscuits and cakes and all to eat, okay? But after a few days they got thoroughly sick of that, and even though there was a lot of gunfire and explosions all around the place, all around the city, all the lads could actually, and the women of course, could actually think about was fried bacon and eggs, you know? Anyway, when they did surrender, they eventually had to surrender. They hadn't come under a lot of attack, so they were kind of wondering, why do we have to surrender? So many of them were visibly upset, and it took, you know, they had to calm them down. But McDonough, what he did as a commandant there at Jacobs was he gave everybody the choice of whether they would actually surrender or whether they would actually, you know, try to get away. So Peter Kearney took the choice of dressing in civilian clothes, and he actually escaped. So he didn't serve time, and he wasn't returned straight after the rising because he didn't surrender. The other person we're dealing with just lived down there, St. Joseph's Place. And he was Peter McPartland. And he was actually involved in the Hibernian Rifles. And the Hibernian Rifles were really part of the volunteers. But they had been involved in 1913 as well, because many of them were actually members of the Irish Transport and General Workers Union. And they used their connections with the Agent Order of Hibernians in the United States to actually get funding from them. And they were out to get you know, extra strike pay during the actual lockdown itself in 1913. Peter served in the GPO, but he also went to some of the outposts in Hopkins and Hopkins, some of these shops along the quays in and around the GPO. And then eventually he was there when they actually walked their way back to Moore Street, where they had to surrender. So he did surrender. They were transported in foul-smelling cattle boats from the North Wall, and he was brought to Stafford Jail. Now, when they arrived at in the town of Stafford, they were given a very hostile reception, because the people there had known that their local regiments had been involved in the fighting here in Dublin in 1916, so given a very hostile reception. Eventually, they were all moved then to Francock, where most people actually went to internment camp in Wales, okay? But as I said earlier on, he was released on the 24th of December, just in time for Christmas. So you can imagine the anguish of a lot of the men that were, and the women, of course, but the men in the prison camps in Francock, you know, wondering how long they were going to be there. They were in relatively harsh conditions. When would they get back to their family? So it must have been a great relief for them when they were released just before Christmas to get back home in time to be with their families. Okay, so now we'll move on, and we're just working our way back across the bridge again, and then you can see Hans Road. We're to go to Peter from Ignatius Road. This is an added extra. It's a bonus, if you like. It's not in the pamphlet. We decided to bring it in later on. There's quite a lot of people here who were involved in 1916. Some of them, there's brothers, the King brothers, they were actually in the Irish Citizen Army. And then you had three members at least of the 1st Battalion. And then you had another member of the 2nd Battalion. He was actually a captain. I think it was in G Company. Thomas Weaver, and he was actually killed in action. He was fighting on O'Connell Street in the Hibernian Bank, so he was actually killed. The Brothers King, one of them actually met Harry Polly that we mentioned earlier on in the Imperial Hotel, and he explained to him what had happened, the fighting that he'd been involved in up around Parliament Street in City Hall. I don't think he was actually in City Hall as far as I can work out. I think he's in one of the surrounding buildings around City Hall, but they had to evacuate City Hall because the British did concentrate at that at an early stage. So certainly one of the King brothers was reassigned to the Imperial Hotel. And then the other one is another brother I know, Martin. He was actually assigned then to Stephen's Green, the guards of Stephen's Green. So he's in Stephen's Green and the Royal College of Surgeons, okay? So we'll move onwards then, and still here with Ernie O'Malley, okay? Ernie O'Malley wasn't involved whatsoever with the build-up to 1906 or anything like that. He wasn't a member of any organisation, and he was pretty kind of indifferent to the whole thing. In fact, when he did see the volunteers, you know, marching and drilling and all the rest, he just regarded them really as toy soldiers, as far as he thought about it. But once 1916 happened, that all dramatically changed. And the first incident for him was he was coming back. He was a student in UCD, a medical student. He was coming back with a friend of his that was from the area as well. And they were going by Trinity. And the officer training corps within Trinity, and they were getting themselves prepared to start the corps at the insurgents in, And one of them, who he kind of knew, said, come on in, we'll give you a rifle and you can help us fire at the insurgents. Then the friend that was with him says, you wouldn't do that and fire on your own fellow countrymen. So that's kind of stored a kind of a national, a latent national awareness in him. So he came back and he must have had a chat. Eventually he and the friend got a rifle and they start firing from, we think the bridge up forward is a walk through, we might see it later on a little bit, and they start firing at some of the pickets that the British Army had mounted on the bridges to secure the bridges along the canal all the way along. So that was his involvement. He got more involved later on. We talk about him a bit more when we go further to Taiwan. Okay? Okay, let's move on. Okay. Yeah, just you step in a little bit, please. Yeah, we were trying not to mention any of that stuff, okay? That's all censored, you know? Yeah, we're here on Lindsay Road, okay? So there's a couple of people I'm going to deal with here. The first one is a guy called Wilmot Irwin, okay? Now, he definitely wasn't involved in any of the organisation of 1916. So he was from a family that would see themselves as being loyal to the British Crown and the Emperor. So they were actually aghast at the whole idea of men and women occupying the GPO and the other buildings throughout the city for the Free Ireland. But he did witness, and he eventually wrote a book about his experiences. But one of the things he did witness was, as they were out walking, you can imagine on an Easter Monday, strolling out with his parents, he noticed these barricades being set up by members of the 1st Battalion under a Captain Sullivan, up at the junction of North Circle Road and Charleville Road and then also McCarver Road. I wonder what was all this about? But fairly quickly the British started to attack those barricades and they started with artillery firing from Grange Gorman over. Now the first shot they actually fired went over the barricades, over the houses and all the way up to what was then called Dunphy's Corner. It's now called Doyle's Corner, I'm sure everybody's familiar with. And it so happens Wilmot's two brothers happened to be up there, so after the shrapnel all landed, they picked up the hot piece of shrapnel as a souvenir, you know. But later on, I mean, those barricades were actually stormed by the Dublin Fusiliers, but the volunteers actually held them off fairly well. Eventually, though, the British just concentrated on firing salvo after salvo of artillery shells, and eventually they had to withdraw, and they withdrew all the way up Prospect Avenue, just over Cross Guns Bridge, Prospect Avenue, and they took shelter in Glasnevin Cemetery, and then some of them actually made their way back to the GPO. The other person we want to talk about here is a complete contrast. There's a guy called Seamus Cavanagh, and he was actually a member of the Irish Citizen Army. So what we just really know about him is where he actually served in 1916, his location, and that was in Stephen's Green. So the main story about Stephen's Green was it became pretty clear it was a bad place to actually set up a garrison because the British just occupied the Shelton Hotel, they had machine gunners and they just fired, and eventually they had to withdraw to the College of Surgeons, and they fought all the way to the end. And again, that was another garrison, if you like, of the 1916 people who weren't willing to surrender. I mean, they had ideas that they would actually make a breakout and even take to the Dublin or Wicklow Hills and actually fight a guerrilla campaign. But eventually the order came through, and they wouldn't even accept the order for surrender that came through from the GPO. But the only reason that they were persuaded to accept the surrender order was the fact that it actually came from James Connolly himself, was signed by James Connolly in particular, surrendering off the point to them. Okay? So they're the two people that were involved here. One was just really a witness, not an impartial witness, and the other was very heavily involved in the whole struggle. Okay? Oh yeah, we just mentioned Claude Bridge, it's a walkover bridge. We think that's where Ernie O'Malley and his friend were firing at the British bridges. You know, you can actually, if you get up, well, we won't do it now, but if you ever for a walk, you can actually see the bridges up there, Cross Guns Bridge. And the British did is the Staffordshire Regiment actually eventually secured that bridge, and we think that's where Ernie O'Malley were actually taking pot shots at the British on this bridge. Yeah? So, Sorry, there's one other person, not actually on Lindsay Road, but on Claude Road, Kitty O'Doherty, and she was a member of Cumann na Bhfáin. So she actually stored weapons. I mean, they got some of the weapons that had been landed at Howth, the Mauser rifles and stuff like that, and other weapons, and they actually stored them in her house. And then during 1916, she wasn't actually involved in the active service or fighting in 1916. She did take messages to Kinnegad and that, they acted as a courier, but she also gave out weapons as well from the house. But in the weeks leading up to 1916, what she was involved in was taking houses, or taking guns from a safe house in Aran Road, up there off Home Farm Road. They were that was owned by a man called Sean O'Shea lived there, and he actually had a company it was during the war, so it was restricted on imports and all that kind of stuff, but he had a special permit for imports, and he was using that, it was called a war permit, he was using that to ship in small arms. But what happened was somebody down the docks, you know, they had their customs people and their spies and all the rest, opened up one of the boxes and seen the small arms and reported back to Dublin Castle. But the volunteers actually had their own informants in Dublin Castle, so they got wind that these small arms had been seen, had been spotted, so the likelihood there would be a raid on Aran Road and they would seize the weapons. So Kitty O'Doherty was given the job with other members of Cumann na Bhfáin to get up to Aran Road and get those weapons out and store them safely in the courthouse. And that was her role in main role in 1916. Yeah. Okay, we're dealing with two people here, and they are in the pamphlet that we produced that you can get at Kennedy's later on. And we're going back to Ernie O'Malley. This is actually where Ernie O'Malley, this was his family home number 7. They moved here in around 1906 from Mayo. So Ernie O'Malley, anyway, he got very inspired by what was happening in 1916. So, but the way he puts it, his family didn't have much of a national faith, okay? They did know Major John McBride. He used to visit the family home when they lived in the West. But there wasn't that much talk about the whole fight for national freedom and all that kind of stuff in themselves. It wasn't really open stuff like that. But plus his brothers were in the British Army, you know, fighting over, certain one was in France and some of them, I think one of them was in around the Middle East, somewhere like that. So he actually had to keep his involvement, his new sense of being inspired to become very much involved, away from his family. But one of the things he did do in the house was he found a fourth edition of the autobiography of Hulk Cohn, and he read that avidly, realised that he needed to know more about what was going on. So he's an example of somebody that was very awakened by the actions of the men and women of 1916. The other person we'll talk about lived, if you sort of work your way down through the lane there, it's on Botanic Road, just up from the Botanic Gardens, and this was Merle Perrault. It's kind of an unusual name, it's a Huguenot name, but she'd been involved from about 1900. She was involved in Inning the Heron that was set up by Maud Gonne, and then she was involved all the way through. She was involved in 1913. She was a member of the Irish Women's Workers' Union, very close to James Connolly and Countess Markovich, and she was a founding member of the Irish Citizen Army, so she'd been involved all the way through. Her involvement in 1916 was mainly as a messenger. She was sent to Cork by Patrick Pearse to basically to counterman the order, okay? So her job was to seek out Thomas McCourtin, who was the leader of the Cork Volunteers. She eventually caught up with McCourtin on a motorbike of all things, and the only reason she caught up with him was because he and Terence McSweeney were travelling around in a motor car, actually issuing the original McNeil countermanding order to the Cork Volunteers. So she caught up with him, and it was just a simple note from Pearse saying, "We go into action at noon today," or PHP, not even signed to Cork, just PHP. It caused a little bit of confusion for them, but at that stage it was kind of too late for them to remobilise everybody. So they left. She couldn't get back to Dublin, so she made her way to Tralee, but she was arrested in Tralee. She was actually known by the detectives there because she'd been involved in something in Tralee prior to that in 1916 around March. So she was arrested and brought back to Mountjoy Prison in Maine, and then eventually she was transported to a prison in England. So that was Mary Perrolls. Okay. Incidentally, some members of her family actually changed their name. They were so embarrassed by the whole thing. They were involved in the 1916. They changed their name from Perrolls. But she was involved all the way through from 1900, as I said. Okay, so we just move down. We can further this role, but we don't want to sort of stand outside. So many of us outside somebody's house. We thought this is the best place to stand. And that deals with Anya and Eamon Kent. This was the home of Eamon's sister, you know, home. But his father also lived here. He was actually buried out of here and buried from the church up there that we just passed. Okay, and everybody's heard of Eamon Kent. He's one of the signatories of the 1916 proclamation. He'd been heavily involved and he was on the military council. He helped set up the Irish Volunteers. And he was in the 4th Battalion and they were fighting in the South Dublin Union. Okay. But the relevance for this house in 1916 is this is where Anya stayed, his wife Anya stayed here. She was a member of Cumann na mBan. She'd been in Cumann na mBan from April 1914 when it had been founded. But the reason she was staying in this house in the aftermath of 1916 was that the British Army raided their house on the south side and actually wrecked the house and they couldn't stay there. In fact, a neighbour had got such a fright with the British, you know, ransacking the house that she actually collapsed and died of a heart attack, you know, and did such damage to the house. So she couldn't live there. But she was here the night, it was on Sunday the 7th of May, when the British had sent a car with a British Army officer with a message from Eamon saying that he wanted to see his wife Anya and his sister Nell. Okay? So out in the car was waiting his brother Richard, who actually lived locally enough in Richmond Road, okay, number 71 Richmond Road. They then went and picked up Michael, his other brother, who lived quite locally. So it was actually quite a poignant reunion, as you can imagine, and the way his brother Michael explains it was that Eamon and Anya were like lovers again for the last quarter of an hour of their life on earth together, and that's the way he put it, you know. Now when they were talking, there was still this idea that it could have been a reprieve, there's still some hope of a reprieve. So, you know, Eamon said his goodbyes to his wife and his relatives, but it was a qualified goodbye, you know, conditional goodbye. You know, he might be actually seeing him again, but he was executed the next day on the 8th of May okay. That's about it on that one. We just make our way down, we're going to get to Carlingford Road and we'll talk about Nellie Gifford, okay? We're on Carlingford Road here, so this is where Helen Ruth Gifford, as she was known at the time, she later married a Donnelly. But we'll talk to her from the point of view as being Nellie Gifford, okay? And she was involved from around 1908. She joined the Irish Women's Franchise League that was set up by Hannah Shee Skeffingham. So they were fighting for the votes for women and that, so she'd been involved from that point. But she was also famously one of the sisters of the sister of Grace, who married Joseph Plunk in Cumann, which everybody probably knows about. And then she was Muriel, her other sister, was married to Thomas McDonough, so that's what she's known for. But she did have involvement in her own right. She was very involved in things all the way through with her sisters as well. So she was involved in the Irish Citizen Army as well during 1913. Which she joined the Irish Citizen Army after it was founded, during 1913. But during the 1913 lockout, she mainly got involved in soup kitchens and milk parlours to help people affected by the strike. But she was the famous example where James Larkin actually spoke from the balcony of the Imperial Hotel. She was involved in that as well. James Larkin dressed up as a clergyman. And then to kind of add to the whole thing as well, she was acting as his niece and doing a lot of talking, so he could actually get access to the balcony And he gave a speech out over at Cole Street, in which the the Dublin Metropolitan Police actually baton charged the people in O'Connell Street. But most of whom were just out for a stroll, because most of the workers were actually down in Fairview, where the union had a recreation centre, as it so happened. So she was involved in 1916 in Stevens Green, and what she did was she helped set up a first aid post, and what's called a commissariat. I never knew this word before, but seemingly it's where they give out food provisions and all for the troops. So she was involved with setting that up in the GPO, or sorry, in Stevens Green in the park. And then later she had to withdraw then to the Royal College of Surgeons, just like the rest. So she was there to surrender. But she was arrested, and she was only held for a few weeks in Clonmany jail. And she famously wrote her name there to say that she was there in the cell of Clonmany, which I believe you can still actually go and visit and actually see Clonmany in the world there, if you so wish. Okay, so that was Nellie Gifford, okay? Hollybank Road, there was a number of volunteers associated with Hollybank Road, but the one that we'll dwell on is actually Thomas Duke. He was actually in the 5th Battalion, okay? They were centred in around North County Dublin and even Meath, and they were under the leadership of Thomas Ash. So basically what they did, because of the countermanding order, they didn't really have enough forces, so they kind of split up into two, and they went sort of some kind of more into Meath, Ashbourne, I think it was actually Ashbourne. But Duke himself was involved in the actions at Swords in Garristown, where they actually attacked the RIC barracks there, okay? Now, the other relationship between the 5th Battalion and the 1st Battalion, I mentioned earlier on that when we were talking about Pierce Baisley, that one of the jobs or the ideas of the 1st Battalion when they were centred down the Four Courses is to keep a corridor open up towards North County Dublin and Meath. But Thomas Ash was explained to Pierce Baisley later when they were in Lewis Prison together that they did have a plan, and Thomas Ash actually sent somebody down from the 5th Battalion. I don't know whether it was Thomas Duke, possibly not. But they did send somebody down to try and tie in with the 4th Battalion and to meet them at Crossguns Bridge. But when the volunteer from the 5th Battalion got there, there was nobody there, so nothing came off that, you know. So that was really, really the story. I know we were saying earlier on that most of the stories about the Irish Citizen Army, the 1st Battalion, the 2nd Battalion, but that brings in a little bit of a story of the 5th Battalion as well. Okay, and that's the end of the talk. Thank you for your time. We are assembling in Kennedy's, there's some leaflets, there's an exhibition, there's a poster there with all the names and the locations of, like, this is only just a small sample of the people that were involved, but there's, I don't know, the many is there marked, there's 120 or something names that we have, and you can see all those names there. Plus there'll be sandwiches as well, and I think Kennedy's do drink as well, and it's relatively cheap as well, especially at this time of year, okay? So once again, thank you for your time. We will be having further events, you know, as we commemorate, like, the opening of the first ball, and the war that followed after, the struggle for freedom that followed after that. We will be commemorating the people of Drumcondra and district who actually participated in that as well. So people are welcome to stay in touch and keep in contact about these things as well. I know even talking to some people here, they had their own family stories in relation to people that were involved around that period of 1913 to 1923. So we welcome feedback as well, that we can maybe print things as well about that, or add them to the treasure trove of information that there does exist out there, okay? You're very welcome. Thanks very much.
Well done.